In your pew, you're going to see a prayer request card. If you or someone you know needs to be lifted up in prayer, just say, hey, fill it out, put it in the offering plate on your way out, because we have a group of people who come together to pray specifically over your request. Also, church directories have arrived. If you haven't picked up your church directory just yet, you can do so after the service. If you're here this morning, you just go to the fellowship hall, and my wife will help you with that. If you would like to stop by the church Monday through Thursday, you can pick up the directory as well. Our virtual charge conference will be held via Zoom on Wednesday, October 7th at 6 p.m. Also, there are extra copies of the Fall Quarter Adult Bible Study Literature available in the Narthex. And this Saturday is a special Saturday. It is a Saturday where the great pumpkin comes to Okeechobee. And we are looking for volunteers to help unload some great pumpkins. And if you are able to help us unload a semi-truck full of pumpkins, we would greatly appreciate that. We will hopefully have a team up here that will be able to help as well. And we are starting at 7:30 at the church. We have a little bit of what we call continental breakfast. And then from 8 until whenever we are done, we are unloading pumpkins from a big truck, a really, really big truck. And this year is unlike most years. You know, normally we have plenty of help. And because of the COVID restrictions and so forth, we may not have as much help. So if you can help and you feel able to help, we would greatly appreciate that help as well. Lunch is provided after we get done unloading. We will have pizza and soda and stuff like that in the fellowship hall. So if you can help, again, we would appreciate that. 7:30 to whenever we're done. That would be wonderful. And those are our announcements for this morning.
Good morning, everybody. There's a phrase in this song that we're about to sing, and it says, "And I have lived in the goodness of God." It really touches me, because I think back, I can't remember a time in my life that I didn't feel the presence of God. And he's always been there regardless of how far away I have gone from him. He's been there. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. All my life.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Come to the time of prayer this morning, and there are some people we want to lift up in prayer. The Suarez's, as they are going through the COVID-19, we want to continue to keep them in our prayers. Carolyn Bartlett, we want to continue to keep her in our prayers, as she has been going through the same. True Hearts, as they've been going through the same with the COVID-19, we want to continue to lift them up in our prayers as well. Also, Cecil Funkhauser, I think, was it Thursday, he turns 8 years old. Yeah, so here's a milestone this week. And Cecil, that also means you get to play from the forward tees when we play golf now. So that's an extra perk for you. All right.
I've been waiting for that.
So that is awesome. Also, we want to keep just one another in prayers. You know, some of the people who are going through difficulties and so forth, whether it's financial, whether it's just relationships with family. We want to keep our nation in prayer, those who are suffering with the pandemic and the civil unrest. We want to keep the world in our prayers because there's this possibility that there could be an uptick, you know, of COVID coming back during the fall because it's part of the seasonal flu thing going on. And let's just keep one another safe and in our prayers and look out for one another as Christ looks out for us. So let's go to our Heavenly Father this morning in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this wonderful day you have given us to be in the house of the Lord. Whether you're joining us, Lord, Facebook Live, or you're in the presence of us being gathered here together, Lord, we just thank you. We thank you for being our God. We thank you for allowing us to come to worship you. We thank you for this morning you have given us, that we have awakened and be able to be here. For your house, Lord, is important, but your people are even more important. Lord, may our hearts reflect the love of Christ in all things that we do. And may we never forsake the assembly of coming together in Jesus' name. And Lord, we just thank you. Thank you for being our God who provides for our every need. And you are Jehovah Rapha, the God that heals. Lord, and we just pray for a healing to be upon the hearts of each and every one of us. Lord, that there may be peace in our land. May we be together a people that turns from our ways to God's ways, that we may experience the joy of the Lord and in his presence, Lord, may we live. Lord, we just thank you for all that you have done and all that you will continue to do. We thank you, Lord, for the hearts of those, Lord, that you have changed, and those that need to be changed, Lord. May we be the example, the hands and feet of Christ, so that they may come to know you by. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great country and the leadership of it. We pray for our president, our governor, and mayor, also those men and women who make decisions for us. Heavenly Father, we pray for those who are sick, those who would love to be here but can't, those who are going through financial difficulties, Lord, those who are going through relationship difficulties. Lord, you know the needs of each and every one of us, those that are fighting off the COVID and other illnesses, Lord. For there are many people who are going through cancer treatments and heart treatments. Lord, the good report from Gina Abergas about her son, you know, is on the mend, Lord. That's you. That's you being involved in the process, Lord. You guiding the hands of the doctors and the nurses that treat them. And Lord, may we continue to be that kind of a people that depends on you. May we not be independent in our hearts from you, but dependent in our hearts for you and your guidance. And Heavenly Father, we thank you for this church and its many facets of ministries. We pray for our children's ministry, our youth ministry, our adult ministries, Lord. We thank you for our pastor and his wife and family, Lord, for they have served our church faithfully. And Lord, we just pray that that through it all, that means when this season of 2020 is over, through it all, that more people will come to see Jesus. And Lord, may the leadership of this church reflect the outreach of who Christ is in our community and in our homes. And Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who went to the cross, who bore our pain and our shame. And because of who he is and everything that he has done, Lord, I pray that if there are those here this morning who have not heard the gospel message preached, who have never been given the invitation, Lord, that you will prepare their hearts. And Heavenly Father, that you will draw those hearts to the Son, as your scripture says you will. Heavenly Father, may we all come to the understanding of who Christ is. For Jesus asked Peter, "Who do you say I am?" And Peter said, "The Christ, the anointed one of God." And Lord, may we come to understand that important question and how it has relevance in our life. And Lord, may we together as a church pray the prayer that Christ taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
scripture this morning comes from the book of Matthew, the 21st chapter, beginning at the 23rd verse. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked. Jesus replied, "I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or from men?" They discussed it among themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't we believe him? But if we say from men, we are afraid of the people, for they hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then he said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work today in the vineyard.' 'I will not,' he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, 'I will, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted?" "The first," they answered. Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him, but the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him." Here ends the reading of God's word. May he add his blessing to it. Today's context of the Jesus going to the temple is the day after his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Palm Sunday, with all of its excitement, is what precedes this. In fact, it is Palm Sunday followed by the cleansing of the temple, followed by the cursing of the fig tree. And on Monday, Jesus goes to the temple to teach. And while he was teaching, the Pharisees, the chief priests, and the elders of the people came to him. Can you imagine if a pastor got up the week after Palm Sunday and used this as his text that morning? It's Easter Sunday. You've got to preach about the resurrection. And I always have. And so we slide these verses to the end of the church year and preach about them, but we leave out the context of the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. It's important to realize the crisis is at hand. Jesus has entered Jerusalem to the cries of Hosanna, to the cheering of the people, and the Jewish leaders are anxious. What are we going to do with this man? Now, the plot has been well underway for some time. They've been looking for an opportunity to get Jesus in a quiet place. And yet they're still willing to confront him in the temple before the people. There's a whole crowd gathered listening to Jesus. It's the day after his triumphal entry, and there is an excitement in the room. There's an energy building with everything that Jesus says. We don't know the content of his teaching from Matthew's gospel on this day. We know about the interruption to his teaching. While he's teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. By what authority are you doing these things? By what authority have you cast out the money changers? By what authority have you entered into Jerusalem to the cries of Hosanna? Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Jesus says he'll answer them on one condition. That he gets to ask them a question before he has to answer theirs. They're like, oh, okay, you ask yours and then we want to hear your answer. And he asks, by what authority did John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or from man? I could almost see the sidebar huddle of the leaders. Okay. Now, if we say it was from heaven, he's going to ask us, why didn't we believe in him? And if we say it's from men, all these people are going to be upset with us. And so they ducked the question. We don't know. Now they knew. They just weren't willing to say. They believed it was from men. It's the only excuse for not listening to what John said. But they were afraid. Afraid of the people, the very same people who shouted Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Some of the same people who will shout, crucify him. Just 4 days away. But they were more concerned at that point about the crowd condemning them. And so they said, we don't know. And Jesus, of course, answered, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. Jesus' authority was from heaven. But there was no point in declaring that to the Jewish leaders because they weren't willing to hear it. They weren't unable to hear it. Jesus could have shouted from the pinnacle of the temple, from the mountaintops, and they weren't able to hear. My authority comes from heaven. And so Jesus tells them a parable. Not only the leaders who asked this question, but everyone who was there, he asks them, a man has two sons. And he goes to the first and says, son, go and work today in the vineyard. And the son says, I will not. But later he changes his mind, he goes and he works. The second son, oh yeah, Dad, I'll get right on it. Got it. And then he doesn't go. And Jesus asks them, which one has done the will of his father? Well, it's pretty obvious. The one who said no but went is the one who did it, not the one who said, I'll get right on it, and never went. And then Jesus makes the point of the parable. I tell you the truth, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe. These words are not just for the religious leaders 2,000 years ago. Jesus speaks these words to us. When he says, go, some of us give lip service to that command. I'll get right on it. I'll go when I get a chance. I'll go right after I finish what I'm doing now. Jesus calls us to go into the world and to love others in his name. And if we say, yes, Lord, but don't lift a finger to make a difference, are we not functioning like the second son, who was willing to say, I'm on it, but never went? We've got to follow through with what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Love one another as I have loved you. That's what it means to do the Father's work. And if we fail to do it, God. Can we be a child of God and not do what He says? I suspect that all of us have somewhere along the way made some level of commitment to follow Jesus, to invite Him into our hearts. It makes us sons and daughters of God. But if we don't live out that calling to love, then a whole lot of other people are in line ahead of us. My father went to church all of his life. He sat in a pew in lots of different churches. But late in his life, we were having a discussion at my sister and brother-in-law's home. And my brother-in-law had fairly recently gone to a training with Evangelism Explosion. And in it, they're instructed to ask a person, if you were to die today, what would you say to God as to why you should get into heaven when you get there? And so Scott asked the question. And my dad kind of hemmed and hawed, and, you know, I've lived a good life. I've been to church a lot over the years. And Scott pressed and said, the only correct answer is, I've given my life to Jesus Christ. And I can't remember the exact statement. And it's at that point, Dad turns to me and says, Don, is this what you believe? And I'm like, Dad, I have been preaching this over and over and over again. You've been to my services. You've heard my sermons. Yes, this is what I believe. And so he says, well, I'll tell you what, if the whole family will come up to Don's church one Sunday soon, and if we sing really good songs that morning, then I'll go down to the altar and commit my life to Christ. It is the fastest my sister ever made arrangements to come to my house at church. And just a couple of Sundays later, we sang my dad's favorite hymns, and I preached my really best sermon, and he came down to the altar and committed his life to Christ. I always believed that he actually made the commitment in their living room. My sister always believes that Dad really committed his life right after he was diagnosed with cancer some months later. I know that he faced death with a peace that he never had in life. Whenever the subject of death would come up, Dad was out of the room, and he would leave with, "You'll miss me when I'm gone." And it happened time after time after time. We'd get talking about someone dying, "Oh, I'm out of here. You'll miss me when I'm gone." He just couldn't handle any discussions of death. And yet that same man asked me to preach his funeral when he died. I was so uncomfortable because he had been so uncomfortable for so long. I was like, "Dad, we don't have to talk about this now. It's not coming right around the corner." He said, "When the time comes, son, I just want you to preach my funeral." Y'all never knew Dad. He's been gone for a long time. He was in that 11th hour of employees that went to the Father's fields. He was the son who said, "No." But in the end, he said, "Yes." May we not wait to the end of our lives to begin living for Him. It's important to say yes. That yes really needs to be backed up with a life lived for Christ. May we do whatever it takes to be about the work in our Father's vineyard, to say the yes with our hearts. Let us pray. Lord, be with us. Dear God, forgive the times we've said, "Yes, we'll work in your vineyard," and then continue to go about our lives and forget all about your call upon our hearts and upon our lives. Lord, if there's anyone here this morning who has never said the yes, if there's anyone watching this morning who has never said yes, Lord, let them say yes with their whole heart and their whole life. From this day forth and forevermore. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is "Trust and Obey," number 467.
seated and keep your masks on if you're singing.
Preserve and keep us all now and forevermore. Amen.